Jesus Christ, Christ in you, the hope of glory, that when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there, and then I'll fly away. Lesson. If you have a Bible, please be ready to turn to, I guess, the book of Revelation.
I think they worked on that.
All right, well, good morning, everybody. As you probably know, we've been having this prophecy conference Friday evening, all day yesterday, and We wanted to have our two visiting speakers to also present on Sunday morning. Olivier Melnick presented in Sunday school, and now Don Perkins is going to be presenting in the main service. Don is here with his wife, Marie, so it's very easy to remember, Donnie and Marie. And you'll see his resource table, I think, to the right as you walk in and out. It would be nice to have him go home less burdened with stuff, so I would encourage his resources. He's someone I've actually known for about 20 years through the pre-trib study group. You can watch his show on his channel. If you watch his channel, I like to go onto their website and select Don Perkins and get his half-hour show that he does, weekly on his channel. His ministry is called According to Prophecy Ministries, and the title of his message this morning is Bible Prophecy, God's Order of Events. So he's going to take the whole prophetic scenario and put it in order before 12:30. And I'm kind of curious how he's going to pull this off, because as you guys know, I can't even get through a verse before 12:30. So with that in mind, let's welcome Brother Don Perkins.
Well, Pastor, I thank you so much, and I will end by 12:30. You know why? Because I want to come back. You know, most time, you know, you get excited about what you're doing, but you gotta stay focused. Now, what I'm going to do before I get into the message, I'm going to mention a few things that we brought with us. You guys have been quite generous to us clearing out our table. I thank God for that. But we do have a little bit more. You can just take the rest if you like. I'm going to mention some of the books. This is one book I didn't mention because Dr. Reagan was here and he actually had it. This is one of Dr. Reagan's newest book, which I love. It is What is the Difference Between the Millennium and a Millipede? Now, it looks like a children's book from the cover, but this is a wonderful book, in depth, dealing with the millennial reign of Christ. A very good book. Dr. Reagan is a great teacher as well, so we actually offer this one through our ministry as well. Again, because of all the other books that are gone, we have a number of DVDs and CDs. This is called The Twofers. This is The Two Comings. Here we have The Rapture of the Church and The Second Coming of Christ. We have the two realities, the reality of heaven and the reality of hell. We also have the two judgments, the judgment seat of Christ and the great white throne judgment. We have that on DVD and USB as well. Yesterday, I taught on the mark of the beast, what it is and what it is not. I would encourage you to stop by and get those as well. We also talked about our series. It's called Understanding the Book of Revelation. It's called Pack 1, Pack 2. This is 24 DVDs. We covered the entire book of Revelation in 71 programs at his channel. We also have it in three USB format. Again, it's a 30-minute program. Each segment is 30 minutes, but it took us 2 years to complete it. But we go in-depth to look at the book of Revelation. Now, the message this morning, Bible Prophecy, God's Order of Events. And again, I'm going to give you a general overview of Bible prophecy. We're going to bring in our prophecy chart, which is a dispensational chart. But what I have on the table there, at his channel, I did a 12-part series on this particular message. I slowed it down, and we literally covered the entire chart. But we did it on this DVD, as this DVD pack and USB pack in 12 messages. So we cover a lot, but I'm going to give you a quick version today. All right. Then we have our website, which is www.according2prophecy.org. As I shared yesterday, we've been online since 1995. We're also part of the social media platforms as well as his channel. I would encourage you to go to his channel. You can download their app as well or go to hischannel.com. There we have our program, which is Your Future in Bible Prophecy. And again, our focus is on Bible prophecy. And again, try to make it simple for the average man. Then we have our app. You can go to our app. You can actually scan it here. Or at our table, we actually have this QR code there. You can just scan it just with your phone, touch it. It'll bounce you right to the app store, and you can download the app there. We have a video of the month. This month, for February. The message there is, what is it, 10? No, we're, oh goodness. 10, no, I'm sorry, I don't want to mess it up. Go to the website and get it. I looked at it this morning and I was going to tell it, but hey, all right. Now, the message this morning, Bible prophecy, God's order of events. I want you to bow your hearts as we ask the Lord to bless his word. Father God, we love you, and all, as always, it's a privilege first and foremost that as we stand before you, the creator of all life. Lord, what a privilege and honor it is to serve you. Lord, a privilege today as we stand before your people. And Lord, I ask today by your Holy Spirit, as we go into the word, I ask that you open up the scriptures to our hearts. Let our hearts burn within us as you teach us your word. Lord, as you remove doubt, as you clear, give us clear confidence in your prophetic word. Lord, we come against the works of the enemy that would try to confuse, oh God. And Lord, we just ask today that the peace of God would just rest as we learn your word. Now, Lord, we thank you. Let it challenge us. Let it strengthen us to do your will in these latter days. We love you and we thank you now in Jesus' name. Amen. I really love this message. Most of the time when I come to a church for the first time, this is the message that I teach. I like to give a general overview of Bible prophecy. And you look here, this is a wonderful mosaic of just prophecy things. You have Christ in prophecy. You have the resurrection. You have the beast coming out of the earth. You have the beast coming out of the earth here and out of the sea here. You have Armageddon, just different aspects. But, you know, a lot of people in the world think that, you know, because they're looking at all of the bad things in the world, they think that this world is running aimlessly by itself. Well, I want to declare this morning that God is in control and he has a divine order. I want to say as well, saying that nothing that is going on today has caught him off guard. You know, God's not surprised about nothing that's going on. We are surprised because, again, a lot of times we don't understand what he's doing, or we don't understand the word of God. Well, we're going to look here this morning and see some beautiful things. Now, I'm going to bring in our prophecy chart. It may look a little confusing to you now, but hang on. We'll give you some clarity. It's going to help you. Now, this first line you see come through, this first line will be prophetic events that will happen in the heavens. The middle line will be prophetic things that will happen on planet Earth. And then the bottom line would be things that would take place in the underworld. And again, we're going to look at a lot of different things based on prophecy to give us a divine order. Now, I'm a topical teacher. I'm going to give you some topics this morning. We're going to look at what is Bible prophecy. I like to define it. What is Bible prophecy? Then we'll look at what does the Bible say about God and Bible prophecy? What is Father God's relationship to Bible prophecy? Then we'll look at why should we study Bible prophecy? Why should this message be a part of your Christian diet? Why should your pastor host a prophecy conference? Why should you study the book of Revelation at least once a year? Why should it be a part of your Christian diet? We'll look at a number of things there. And then last, we're going to give an overview of Bible prophecy. And what I'm going to do here, I'm going to bring our prophecy chart in, and then we're going to take that prophetic ride. And we're going to see some amazing things. So I want you to hang on. It's going to be a fast ride. Buckle up, but it's going to be good, all right? I want to start off here in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 19 through 21. I love to start here. Peter wrote this. He said, "We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well that you take heed as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts." He said this, "Knowing this, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost." I really love this. Here, Peter said that we have a more sure word of prophecy. Listen, saints, you can stand on the prophetic word in Scripture. It's a sure word. You can have confidence and peace in it. Then he said that the prophecies, they were of no private interpretation. And what I love about that, God did not give all of Bible prophecy just to one prophet. All through the Bible, God gave, he gave Moses some of it. He gave Zechariah, he gave Micah. And in that, he protected the integrity of Bible prophecy. Now, the times that we're living in is so beautiful because we can see prophecy literally come to pass, and we can see a panoramic view of what God is doing. And again, I love how he protected it. Verse 21 said that the prophecy didn't come privately. In other words, God did not just cause one person to do it. But Scripture says the Holy Spirit moved upon these prophets of old, and they began to write prophetically. Now, these men, centuries apart, years apart, and their prophecies connected, you know, like a puzzle. And again, we're going to see some beautiful things here as we go through the Scriptures. Now, I want to quote here from the late Dr. Chuck Missler from his book, Prophecy 2020. Listen to what he says about Bible prophecy. He said, "We don't take prophecy seriously because it's in the Bible. We take the Bible seriously because of the track record of his prophecies." You know, one of the questions I get all the time, "Brother Perkins, how do you know that Bible is the right one? What about the Book of Mormon? What about the Quran? How do you know that Bible is the correct one?" Well, one way we know it is because of Bible prophecy. We have a book here that reads like a current day newspaper. Only a sovereign God that knows the future can reveal it in advance. And again, we can trust it. So I trust my Bible because of what we see before us today. Quoting here from the book, The End of All Things by Dr. Richard Booker. Listen what he said here. He said, "When we study the Bible and world history, we see that God has a plan for mankind and that he is actively moving world events forward to fulfill that plan. He has written these events in the Bible so we can know his plans and see it unfold throughout the pages of world history. It is all there in the Bible. It would just take time to study for ourselves." This is one reason why I said Christians should not be afraid of the times. The Word of God says, "Wisdom and knowledge shall be the stability of your times." When you understand what God is doing, when you understand God's prophetic plan that's in Scripture, it's a stabilizer. It gives you peace. You know, I sleep good every night. Even though the news talks about Putin, rattling, and this guy and that person doing this, or something explode over there. When I go to sleep, saints, I sleep so good. And the reason why I do, because a sovereign God is in control, and he has revealed the future in advance. And again, we're going to see that. Now, what is Bible prophecy? So I'm going to give you some understanding. And many of you here, I'm singing to the choir, but again, I just want to encourage you. You know, Peter said this. He said, "As long as I'm in my body," he said, "I want to stir you up by way of remembrance. Even though you know it, I'm going to stir you up." So this morning, I want to stir some of you up this morning. All right, what is Bible prophecy? Prophecy signifies the speaking forth of the mind and counsel of God. If you want to know the future in reference to God, you need to study Bible prophecy, because God is so clearly giving it to us. Prophecy is not necessarily nor even primarily foretelling. It is the declaration of that which cannot be known by natural means. I love this. It's the foretelling of the will of God, whether with reference to the past, the present, or the future. It's the foretelling of the will of God. God is telling us his plans in advance. I love this. Quoting Dr. John W. Bradbury from his book, A Sure Word of Prophecy. Listen to what he says about Bible prophecy. "Christian eschatology and prophecy are interwoven in the teachings of the Bible to such an extent that the knowledge of the first is limited to the extent that we comprehend the second." And I really like this because, you know, if you don't understand the end of the story, it affects what you believe in the middle. You know, if you don't understand the Genesis record, it affects what you believe in the middle. You must understand the Genesis record and the Revelation record to understand the complete text of Scripture. And when you do that, the Bible just comes together. He goes on to say this: "Every doctrine of the Christian faith has its conclusion or culmination in that future, which is the burden of biblical prophecy. And ignorance of this prophecy or any perversion of it seriously affect one's concept of the pure faith. It is for this reason, therefore, that a clear biblical expression concerning Bible prophecy is necessary." We need to have a clear message of Bible prophecy taught in the Scriptures. You know, there are a lot of YouTube guys out there, a lot of YouTube prophets out there, and a lot of Christians are getting caught up in some wacky stuff because they don't know the Scriptures. You need to know what the Word of God says about the end times before you join a lot of these Johnny-come-lately prophets. It's dangerous, and I want to tell you. Now, in the quote there, he talked about eschatology. Now, I do teach in Bible college as well, so I want to define the term eschatology for those that don't know, and I love this. What is eschatology? The eschatology is a division of systematic theology dealing with the doctrine of last things, such as death, resurrection, the second coming of Christ, the end of the age, divine judgment, and the future state. It properly includes all that was prophetic of future events when recorded in the scriptures. Biblical eschatology assumes that the scripture predict, listen at this, events with infallible accuracy and constitutes a divine disclosure of the future. What I teach as a Bible prophecy teacher, I teach eschatology. I deal with the last things. Now, I teach the whole counsel of God from Genesis to Revelation, but my area of ministry deals with the end of the story. He goes on to say this. Eschatology is not designed to satisfy curiosity. God's not concerned about your curiosity. It is not designed to satisfy curiosity, but to provide an intelligent comprehension of the future as a guide for a present program and a sure ground of hope. You know, God wants you to have a sure ground of hope. He wants you to know what you believe and what you stand on. You know, saints, it's amazing that I'm a Bible prophecy teacher. I was taught when I was in church as a young guy that if you studied the book of Revelation, you could lose your mind. In church, Andy, I was taught that. When I became a Christian in my young adult life, I would go through the Bible, but I never would go to the book of Revelation. I left that book alone because I didn't want to lose my mind. I found out that it was a lie of the enemy. Now, I did read it, and I did lose my mind. I lost my mind, and I put on the mind of Christ, which is so good. Hallelujah. Bible prophecy has given me such peace, you know, because I understand what God is doing. And again, we're going to see this going forward. Now, what does the Bible say about God and Bible prophecy? What is Father God's relationship to Bible prophecy? And I love this so much. In the book of Isaiah 46:10, I love this passage. It says, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. You know, God is big and bad and bold to declare the end of the story at the beginning. God says, I'm going to tell you what's going to happen, and when I tell you, it's going to happen exactly like I said. You can trust him. You can trust him. Look at this, Isaiah 48, verses 3 through 5. God says, I have declared the former things from the beginning, and they went forth out of my mouth, and I showed them, and I did them suddenly, and they came to pass. Look at verse 5. He said, I have even from the beginning declared it to thee. Before it came to pass, God says, I showed it to you. Let me tell you something. What I've been reading in scripture got me so excited because God has showed me how the end is going to look. You know, we say this statement, you know, say we break this statement, you know, I read the end of the book and it's going to be blessed. That's true, but you really need to read the end of the book. Because what God has revealed to us is going to be so exciting. It is unbelievable what God has in store for us. You know, understanding the end time message gives you value to what God has in store for you. And you're not so quick to give it up. Now, why should we study Bible prophecy? I'm going to give you a number of reasons why we should study Bible prophecy. Reason number one, because we are commanded to study the word of God and the message of Bible prophecy is in the Bible. Now, during this conference, I've heard two different things. I'm going to add number three to it. I've looked at it as 33% of the scripture. I heard 30%. I heard 27%. So from 27 to 33% of your Bible is prophetic. It's prophetic in nature. When you do a Bible study or read through the Bible in one whole year, 27 to 33% of that is prophetic. The problem is we just read our Bibles rather than study. I want to encourage you to slow down a little bit. Slow down a little bit and read the word and let God open the scripture. When you study scripture, you're going to read Bible prophecy. Why should we study Bible prophecy? Listen to this. Because Bible prophecy answers hard questions that no other study in the Bible answers. I'm going to give you some examples. Number one, what happens to the dead after death? You know, Bible prophecy answers that question. The Bible says, for the righteous, we absent from the body and we're what? Present with the Lord. Well, it also answers that question for the unredeemed as well. Luke 16, Jesus gave an account of a rich man going to hell. Now, he didn't go to hell because he's rich. He went to hell because he didn't repent. It's not a parable. Luke 16 is not a parable. Many Bibles have on the header the parable of the rich man. That's not a parable because Jesus talked about a certain man. Not only that, but in that account, Jesus talked about Abraham, Moses, and the prophets. That's not a parable. It's an actual account of a man going to hell. So the Bible and Bible prophecy reveals what happens to the righteous when they die, as well as the unrighteous. Here's another one. Where will Satan's end be? You know, all my life growing up, whenever I saw the devil, he had a red slicker suit on and a pitchfork in his hand. And every time I saw him, he was down in hell burning the sinners, just burning them up. I was taught that all my life. I saw a sitcom that came on. It was called That Poor Devil, starring Sammy Davis Jr. And in this account, Sammy Davis Jr. was in hell, and his job was keeping the coals on the fire to burn sinners. When I was a young, impressionable kid, this is what I said to myself. I said, you know, when I go to hell, that's the job I want. I'm going to keep them sinners burning, man. A lie of the enemy. The devil lied. And see, a lot of people got some weird ideas about their future that is totally unbiblical. You know, Satan is not in hell now. You know, the Bible said that the devil, he is afraid of hell. Hell is a judgment created by God. Matthew 25:41, for the devil and his angels. Isaiah 5 said that hell have enlarged herself, and God has enlarged it to accommodate the fall of man. But it was never, Satan never controlled hell. He does not have offices down in hell. Yeah, Bible prophecy cleared that up for me. What about this one? Will the earth be totally destroyed? Everybody's worrying about, will somebody hit that one nuclear button that's going to totally annihilate planet Earth? You know, saints, I don't worry about that. You know why? Because I read the end of the book. God has already mapped out how the world is going to end, and is not going to end by nuclear destruction. You can rest in that. Now, it doesn't mean that nuclear bombs won't go off in the world, but I can tell you this, mankind can't destroy it because it's not written in the scriptures. We can rest in God, a sovereign God. Here's another one. Heaven and hell are these real places. There's so much debate about heaven and hell. You know, there's so much in the Bible that talks about both places. God put it there so we can spend time. You know, there are three levels of heaven, the sky, the universe, and the third heaven. There are five compartments of hell: Abraham's bosom, Tartarus, Hades and Sheol, the abyss, and then the lake of fire. All these places are part of that underworld. The Bible is clear. It gives us answers and things about that. Here's the last one. Are we living in the last days? How many would agree that we are? You know why? Because Bible prophecy gives us those type of answers. So Bible prophecy answers these type questions. And again, we're going to see something going forward. Now, why should we study Bible prophecy? Because Bible prophecy gives hope to a dying world. It gives hope beyond this present world's problems. I want to give you a scripture here. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse number 19. The Apostle Paul wrote this. He said this, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. When I first read this verse challenged me so much. I said, what are you saying, Apostle Paul? He said, even as a Christian, if you have hope in Christ in this world, he said, you are a miserable believer. You know why, saints? Because this hope goes beyond this present world. Listen, saints, we're living in a world that has been condemned. We're living in a world that's dying. We're living in a world today that is full of sin. Your hope has to go beyond this current world. Now, it doesn't mean that you're so heavenly minded, you're no earthly good. Listen, saints, if you're heavenly minded or future minded, you are earthly good. You know, people tell me all the time, you prophecy guys, man, you. I say, listen, brother, I'm doing good. I'm a good citizen because I understand the end of the story. It gives you hope. Look at this next one, 1 John 3:3. It says, and every man that have this hope in him purifies himself even as he is pure. You know, understanding the end time message, it's a purifier. It'll help you walk on the straight and narrow. It'll keep you from vacillating, keep you from backsliding. You know, I can tell, I mentioned in the conference, I can tell when a Christian don't know the future by how they live in the present. Many Christians, I mean, they give up so easy. Satan can tempt them so easy. They're so quick to give in. Listen, when you understand the future, you're not so easy to give it in, give up on it. It'll keep you holy. It'll keep you walking on the straight and narrow. It'll keep you from backsliding. Look at this next one. I like this next one. Why should we study Bible prophecy? Because Bible prophecy reveals what happens to the wicked or the ungodly in the end. You know, God is not bashful about his plans for the unredeemed. I mentioned in the conference that many times we are the ones who try to lighten the world's load about what God could do. God, all through the scripture, told us exactly what he's going to do. But I'm going to show you something. In the book of Psalm 73, 3 through 23, listen at this. The psalmist thought on the prosperity of the ungodly and almost turned his back on God. So here's the picture. The psalmist was, he came to God, and what happened, he started looking at the wicked prosper. And he said, you know something? Old Joe below down the road, he's not serving God, and he seemed to be living better than I am. I cleanse my hands in vain. He said he almost turned his back on God, looking at the wicked prosper. I want to say to you, saints, I don't care what you're going through today, don't look back. Keep looking forward. Look at this. However, because of the prophecy of judgment on the ungodly, which he learned after he went into the house of God, it caused him not to backslide. So here's a scenario. The psalmist here, this writer, he went into the synagogue, and that particular day there was a Bible prophecy teacher coming to town. Look at verse 17 of Psalm 73. He said, I almost backslid until I went into the sanctuary of God, then understood I therein. In other words, he said, I almost backslid on God, but I went to church that day, and they had a prophecy teacher in town. And he was talking about the end of the story, and he showed me what's going to happen to the wicked. You know something? I'm going to stay with God. Listen, saints, Bible prophecy will help you. It will keep you straight. God is not bashful about what will happen to the ungodly. It's clear, the wages of sin, there's a price to be paid, but you don't want to pay that price. Jesus already paid it for you. The Bible says, whosoever shall call upon his name, they shall be saved. It's simple. Just receive and believe on him. You'll have life. People make it so hard to come to God. But what's going to happen? God's going to judge those who rebel against him. Now, look at this next one. Why should we study Bible prophecy? Because Bible prophecy reveals what happens to the righteous or the godly in the end. That's us, saints. You born again today? God has so beautifully placed in the scripture your future. Look at this. I love this first one. 1 Peter 3, 13. Peter said this. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth wherein dwells righteousness. I love this, saints. Our future will be a future that have new heavens. And when he say new heavens, he's talking about the sky, the sky and the universe, because that has been contaminated by Satan and sin. So when God renovates planet Earth, he's going to renovate the sky and the universe, and we have a brand new sky and universe. And he said a new earth. You know something? This current world that we live on is going to experience a born-again experience. You know, when Jesus went to Calvary's cross, not only did he die for humanity, but at the cross, the crown of thorns was placed in his brow. You know, the thorns was the first curse that entered the earth because of Adam's sin. So guess what? When Jesus died on the cross, he paid for our redemption, but he also paid for the redemption of creation. You know something, ladies, when we go into the new world, the rose bush will not have a thorn. Revelation 22:3 says the curse will be no more. So we look for a new heaven and a new earth. This is our future, the Bible says. Look at this next one. I love this one. Revelation 21:4. I love this. The Bible says, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. Listen, saints, this is the future that God has for the redeemed. You know, and I loved it so much, you know, he said no more tears. He said no more death, no more funeral homes, no more mortuaries, no more graveyards, no more sorrow, no more crying. I love this next one. And no more pain, no more Tylenol, Excedrin, whatever you're using to take care of your pain. No more. Listen at this. He said, for the former things are passed away. Now, you know, I must say this. You know, I turned 64 this year. And Andy, you know, every year I get older, my wife and I, we start singing the senior anthem. Now, let me share with you what the senior anthem is. You know, when I bend down to pick up something, I go, oh. Anybody singing that one? Now, young people, you're laughing at us, but you just hang on. It's coming. You know, God has in store for us, you know, a brand new body where we'll never, ever have pain and sorrow anymore. I'm longing for the day, saints, when there's no more pain in this body. It's going to be awesome. And you know, with that senior anthem, I will say this. It comes automatic, man. That thing just showed up one day. I remember the day I was getting up and I said, whoa. And I said, where'd that come from? I told my wife, Marie, where'd that come from? It's automatic. It shows me that we're part of a condemned world. Entropy, things are dying. We're part of a world. And listen, this is one reason why we need to understand the future that God has in store for us. Our future is going to be beautiful and awesome. And I got one more for you. Why should we study Bible prophecy? Because Bible prophecy, listen to this, it inspires dedicated work and service to God. You know, saints, many of you here, God want to use you in some capacity to service, to serve him. You may not be called to be a preacher like I am, like Pastor Andy and the elders and leaders here, but some capacity God want to use you. God may have a book that he want to write through you. God says, I want you to write this book. And you say, nah, I'm not a writer, God. God said, just yield to me and allow me to work through you. Well, Bible prophecy is a motivator. I want to share with you saying, if we understand the future and how close it is, it's one of those things that will motivate you to allow God to work in your life. So I'm going to give you one example. How many remember Noah? Remember Noah? Noah was the first cruise ship builder. Okay? In the book of Hebrews, look at this. Hebrews 11:7, the Bible says here, by faith, Noah being warned of God of things not seen as yet. That's prophecy. God gave Noah a prophecy that he was going to destroy his world. And look what happened as Noah understood and received that prophecy. The Bible says here that he was moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house by which he condemned the world and became the heir of righteousness, which is by faith. Noah received a prophecy of the end of his world, and it was a motivator. For 120 years, Noah built that ark. He nailed on that gopher wood. Can you imagine in Noah's day what it was like for this man to build this massive boat that nobody didn't know what he was doing? What are you doing, Noah? Crazy man. Cuckoo, Noah. What are you? I mean, the ridicule as these people walking past Noah, and Noah sitting there nailing on that boat. And they now, what was amazing about this, though, I mean, truly this generation at that time, they were really hard-hearted. God had given them signs of the end of their world. And I'll give you an example. I know if me and Sister Perkins and my children were there, there'd be more than 8 people on the boat. It'd be 8 plus the Perkins family. You know why? Because as I'm watching 2 giraffes go on the boat and 2 lions go on the boat and 2 bears go on the boat and nobody's eating each other, I said, wait a minute, Noah got something going on, man. Man, what is Noah up to? Man, I'm on the boat. That was a sign. God was giving them an indicator that the end of their world was coming, and they couldn't discern. They couldn't see it until God says, Noah, go into the boat. Noah went into the boat, and the Bible said, God shut the door, and then judgment fell. Let me tell you something, there are many signs and indicators that are before us today that literally lets us know the season that we're in. As Jesus rebuked the church of his day, or either the Pharisees of his day, he rebuked them because they couldn't discern the signs of the times. The signs were in front of them, but they were dull of seeing. God wants us to understand where we are. This is why your pastor has these type of conferences. You know, I meet Christians all the time. You know, they say, well, I'm not going to that prophecy conference because I'm scared. It's all the doom and gloom. Well, there is doom and gloom, but it's for the unredeemed. If you're born again, you don't have to fear the end times. Your end times is going to be so beautiful, which we're going to see in a little bit. Now, I'm going to give you an overview of Bible prophecy. And what I'm going to do here, I'm going to bring in our prophecy chart here. And then what I'm going to do, you're going to see little circles come in. The first circle you see there, this is the cross of Christ. And we're going to journey from the cross of Christ all the way to eternity. We'll see some amazing things. So first of all, we'll start with the cross of Christ. And again, this is so amazing here. This is one of my favorite studies in Scripture, Christ in prophecy, Christ in the Old Testament. You know, saints, that there were over 300 prophecies that led Jesus to Calvary, of which 100 or so were specific prophecies. Some were repetitive, but 100 or so were detailed. Let me ask you this question. How many pieces of silver was Jesus betrayed with? 30. Why not 35? Why not 36? Why not 50? A nice round number. Well, you know why? Because Zechariah prophesied that 30 pieces of silver would be the price that he was prized at. It was already pre-written. Another question. When Jesus rode into Jerusalem, what did he ride on? Donkey. This is the King of Kings. Why didn't he ride a big charger, a big stallion? This is the King of Kings. He rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. You know why? Because Zechariah said, Israel, behold, your king is coming to you lowly, riding on a donkey. Listen, saints, everything that Jesus did going to the cross was already pre-written in Scripture. When the book came out, the Da Vinci Code, and the movie came out that followed, many Christians' faith became shipwrecked because they didn't know the Scriptures related to the prophecies of Christ. You know something? When that movie first came out and the book came out, I said, that's a lie of the devil. Jesus not prophesied to Mary Magdalene. You won't find that nowhere in the Scriptures. I knew from day one it was a lie of the enemy. I did a meeting in a large woman's prison in Corona, California. And we did a Q&A afterwards. Had probably about 100 ladies got in line for questions. We were there for a good little while, let me tell you. One lady came to me. She said, Brother Perkins, she said, I've read the Da Vinci Code, and I think it's destroyed my faith. What should I do? I said, get rid of the book. Get in your Bible. Tear it up. Rip it up. Don't give it to another prison. Tear it up. You know, Bible prophecy, his whole life was already pre-written in Scripture. This is Christ in prophecy. And again, as a result, he went to Calvary's cross and died. Now, I'm going to take you back to the chart. We're going to see the church age, the rapture of the church, and then the judgment seat of Christ. Now, if you ask me, Brother Perkins, where are we today in prophecy? We're in the book of Acts, chapter 1 through 22. We're still in the book of Acts, saints. Yes, we are. We're in the church age. Not only that, but in the book of Revelation, we're in Revelation chapter 2 and chapter 3. We are no further in the book of Revelation. Don't let anybody tell you we're in chapter 6 in the tribulation. We're in chapter 9. Don't let anybody tell you that. We're in the church age. This is where God is dealing with the body of Christ. God's going to use us to do his bidding in the earth. We're in the church. But what's going to remove the church is the next event called the rapture of the church. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. I love this, saints. I taught this, the first message, and I shared with the saints that I like to take rapture drills. You know, I really do. I remember one night I had a dream. Andy had a dream. Boy, this dream was so good. I had a dream that I was raptured. And brother, I was going up and I was flying. I said, man, this is so nice. Until I woke up. Man, I was mad. Woo. But it was a beautiful dream, man, going up. I cannot wait for the rapture. Saints, the rapture is a message of comfort. This message, this rapture, the Bible talks about, it said, wherefore comfort one another with these words. The rapture will usher us into the presence of our Lord. Saints, I cannot wait to see him. I wait and long to see him. I want to kiss the nail-scarred hands. I want to hug my Savior. This will bring me into his presence. I'm going to see him, and we'll spend eternity with him. We'll get our glorified bodies. The senior anthem will go. The sin nature will go. It's going to be awesome. The rapture has been a message of debate when it shouldn't be. It's a message of hope. And again, we should see it. Now, as a result of that, we're also going to the third heaven to be a part of an event called the judgment seat of Christ. This is powerful. Romans 14:10 and 2 Corinthians 5:10 and 11. Every believer will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Now, you won't be judged for your sins, but you will be judged for your work as a believer. Your work will fall into one or two categories, wood, hay, stubble, or gold, silver, and precious stone. The Bible said that Christians can literally lose rewards at the judgment seat. You don't want to lose any rewards at the judgment seat. The Bible says you can obtain rewards at the judgment seat. You can obtain crowns. I'm going for the crowns. You watch Brother Perkins in heaven. I'm going to have them crowns on my head walking. You said, now, wait a minute, that sounds kind of prideful. Well, the reason why I want the crowns is because I want to lay them at his feet as a gift back to my Savior. I want to do that. Lord, because of you, I've done this or that for you. Sadly, many Christians, they will have nothing to offer to him but the fact that he saved them. Now, you can't lose salvation there. You know, that's not this kind of judgment. And this judgment is only for the redeemed, but it's going to be an awesome, awesome event. And again, I cannot wait to be a part of it. It's going to be awesome. We're going to see the saints of old. Christ is going to judge. Can you imagine Billy Graham being there? I mean, seeing these saints, man, they've gone before. It's going to be awesome. But this is the judgment seat. Now, I'm going to bring you back down to planet Earth, and we're going to see this next event called the seven-year tribulation. Our Savior Jesus said that this is going to be a time this world has never seen nor never ever will see again. Revelation chapter 6 through 19, we have the time of great tribulation. Here, there'll be 21 judgments, seven seal judgments, seven trumpet judgments, and seven bowl of vial judgments. And again, God is going to wreck the world. He's going to shake the world. Mankind don't realize what's coming. And God's going to allow these events to shake the hearts of men. Not only that, but Israel will go through a major season during this time. And listen, Israel will come to Christ as a result of it. Not only will they have these judgments there, but also there will be the man of sin, the Antichrist. God's going to allow Antichrist to wreak havoc for 7 years in the tribulation. The Bible said that those people that are saved during that time, the Antichrist will literally wear out the saints. Those that are born again at that time, they could come under Antichrist's judgment at that time. It's going to be a different world. Not only that, but Antichrist will institute his economic system called the Mark of the Beast. We shared yesterday about the Mark of the Beast. Men cannot buy or sell unless they have that unique mark. Think about this. Not only will you won't be able to buy or sell, you can't even pay your bills during that time because everything is tied to the economy. Can you imagine you can't pay your mortgage or you can't go to the bank unless you have this unique mark? It's going to be unbelievable. Mankind cannot imagine what that time is going to look like. Anybody that's alive as a Christian at that time, he's going to have to go underground to survive this season. But what's so beautiful about the saints is it's going to only last for 7 years. God has given that. The Antichrist has a seven-year season, and God's going to judge him and bring it to an end. But this time is a terrible time. I must say that. It's a judgment. It is doom and gloom, but not for the redeemed. Now, I'm going to take you back up to the heavens. Look at this. I'm going to take you up. We're going to see the judgment seat of Christ. We'll see the second coming of Christ and then the battle of Armageddon. Now, I love this one. I'll be honest with you, saints, the marriage supper. Pastor Andy, when I found out there's going to be food in heaven, brother, I got excited. I don't know what kind of food God's going to serve us, but whatever it is, I'm at the table. Yes. I don't know what's going on, but I'm going to be there. It's going to be awesome. The Bible says, blessed are those that are honored to be a part of this. It's going to be so beautiful. And it's only for the redeemed, the marriage supper of the Lamb. It's going to be beautiful. And it's only for the righteous. We will be there. And it's going to be a great time of fellowship and just honoring. Now, when our food digests, we're going to do something else. You say, wait a minute, preacher. Digest? Your food going to digest? Absolutely. Our food will digest. And what's going on? We're going to mount up on white horses and come back with Christ in the second coming. Now you say, wait a minute, you're saying some weird stuff here now. What do you mean? We're going to eat in heaven, and we're going to have our glorified bodies, same kind of body Jesus. Jesus had a glorified body, and the way God designed the body, he designed the body to work like the body has always worked. That's just the will of God. Once we eat in heaven, we're going to mount up on these white horses and come back with Christ in his second coming. Jesus is going to come back as a man of war. People have never seen Christ in this capacity. The Bible said at this time, Revelation 19, 11 through 16, he's come back with fire in his eyes. And the Bible said that he's going to come back to judge the Antichrist and his armies. And what's going to happen? It's going to be an amazing event. But what I love so much, when Christ comes back, the Bible says he's coming back with a great army. And this army here will literally comprise the redeemed, the glorified saint. That's going to be us. Every one of us is going to come out of heaven riding a white horse. And I'm so excited. I always do this. Every time I do this, look right here, right there. That's Brother Perkins, right there. Oh, yeah. I mean, it's going to be beautiful. My heart's like a Tennessee Walker, man, just stepping. Coming alongside my Savior. I say everywhere I go from coast to coast, I say this everywhere, and I've challenged Christians from coast to coast, name your horse. I've already named my horse, Andy. I've named my horse. I met a lady here at the conference who heard me say that, and she named her horse. And the name of her horse is the same name I gave my horse. Man, that touched me. I want to take a picture with her, man. Now, the name of my horse is Nellie. Every horse I had as a kid, a play horse, was named Nelly. People say, Nelly? I'm thinking, man, Victor and Charger. Or... No, Nelly it is. I want to challenge you, Christian. Name your horse. Every one of us is going to ride these white horses in our glorified bodies, coming back with Christ as he comes back to take full authority in the earth. He's going to conquer the Antichrist and bring an end to his government. And as a result of that, Revelation chapter 19, 17 through 21, it will cause the battle of Armageddon. Here the Bible talks about the blood will come up to the horse's bridle, and it'd be a direct result of the coming of Christ. You know, Jesus come back as a man of war. He's not coming back at that time as a passive lamb. You can't slap his cheek and he give you his other cheek. And I'll tell you this, saints, at the second coming, his donkey riding days are over. He's coming out of heaven as judge. He's coming back to take full authority in the earth. And again, it's going to be amazing, but God has already revealed. This is God's order of events. Now, bring you back to the chart. Now we're going to look at this next phase. It's called the millennial reign, and I love this so much, saints. We're coming back as a glorified saints. We're coming back as Christ, his administration. You know, I will say this. I was a little sad, Andy, when I realized that I'm not going to really fight in Armageddon. Man, I wanted to lay one on the Antichrist, man, just sting him one time, you know? But when we come back, we won't actually fight, even though we're the armies. The glory of Christ, the brightness of his coming will literally do the judgment, but his enemies will be judged. Now, we're coming back as the glorified and as his administration. We're going to come back with Christ to go into his government. We're going to help Christ to rule and reign the entire world. The reason why he's going to use us is because we're glorified. We no longer have the sin nature. We will literally judge the way he judges. Revelation 20, verses 1 through 10, and then Isaiah 9, 6, and 7. He will literally fulfill that prophecy sitting on the throne of his father David. It's going to be awesome. It'll be a theocratic government, meaning a government ruled by God. And what's going to be so exciting, we, the redeemed, will be with Christ to rule. And I don't know where he will send me, but wherever he send me, I'm in the army, man. I'm going to do what you want, Lord. I cannot wait, saints. I cannot wait. I believe I may be a teacher in the millennium. And wait till you see my PowerPoint in the millennium, man. It's going to be awesome, man. Woo-wee. It's going to be awesome. But the millennial kingdom, and what I love so much about the millennium, saints, because the Bible is so clear to give us a lot about it, God will extend mankind's life. The Bible said men will live as long as a tree. You know, the millennium is a precursor to eternity. It's not full because the sin nature is still there. God can put man in a perfect environment and show him that even without the devil's temptation, he'll still sin without Jesus. Believe it or not, you're going to have billions of people born in the millennial kingdom, and many will not come to Christ during that time. It's going to be really sad. They're going to have the Savior there sitting on the throne, and many will still reject him, even in the millennium. God's going to bind Satan, Revelation 20. Satan will be bound for 1,000 years. He'll have no influence in the millennial kingdom. One of the speakers said yesterday that they cannot say the devil made me do it in the millennium because Satan's influence won't be there. But Christ's going to set up his government in fulfillment of Isaiah 9, 6, and 7. He's going to rule sovereignly with a rod of iron. His rule will be the rule of the day, and it's going to be awesome. And I'll tell you this, this is the only time that the world and even Israel will experience peace. You know, we pray this prayer, you know, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem. They shall prosper, they love thee. You know, when you pray for the peace of Jerusalem, you're literally praying for the millennial kingdom. Because it cannot happen unless Jesus Christ brings peace to the region. I think, Andy, you talked about Zechariah's prophecy in regards to the cup of trembling. God, by design, has made the Middle East an unstable cup. And then he said, those that try to stabilize or those to grab that burden, God would cut them in pieces. God's not going to let no president, no prime minister stabilize that area. That's designed for the king. Jesus Christ will fulfill that prophecy to bring peace to Israel and peace to the entire world. It's going to be awesome. Now, as the millennium ends, you can go and clap on that one too. Go ahead. Yeah, it's going to be awesome, saints. Our Savior. At the end of the millennial reign, the Bible said that Satan will be released from his prison. His influence will come back into the earth. And what's amazing there, Revelation 20 says that the deception at the end of the millennium will be amazing. It would be as the sands of the sea. That many people will be deceived even at the end of the millennium. And those people will be judged. And then the Bible says that God will judge the devil. Now, I'm going to take you back up to the heavens and I'm going to bring you back down. Up to the heavens, we're going to see the judgment, the great white throne judgment. And then we're going to see the reality of hell. Now, this one here, the great white throne judgment and the reality of hell are two messages that really stir my heart. These are two messages that have really given me a burden for the harvest. You're looking at an evangelist teacher who loves souls. I go after them because of the great white throne. You know something? Every unredeemed person, man, woman, and even a child who's reached the age of accountability will stand before the white throne judgment and give an account for their rejection of God. And everyone that's here will be eternally damned. There's no hope of salvation at the white throne. The Bible said the books will be open. God's going to open the word of God on them. God's going to show mankind everything he did to save them. Every opportunity, every TV program, every evangelist that tried that God sent across their path and they rejected, they're gonna give an account before God of their rejection. And I'll tell you this too, I believe that everyone that is there, when they are judged, they're gonna know that God is fair. They're gonna know that God, you were right, God. I was a fool. You were right, God. You know, people think that, you know, you can work to get saved and you can do this or do that. God has made it so simple for salvation and mankind rejects him. You know something? There's going to be some really nice people in hell. Good people. People with integrity. They're good moral people, but they hate Jesus. They're going to meet the God of heaven without Jesus. And everyone at the white throne judgment, every one of them, sadly, will be cast into the lake of fire. Now, the lake of fire is a real place, saints. This is the eternal hell, the lake of fire. And it's going to be a very, very a reality for those. A lot of times when I teach on the reality of hell, I don't let people know I'm a teacher on that day. Because sometimes Christians don't show up when they know I'm a teacher on hell. They don't. You know, when you understand hell from a biblical perspective, it gives you a whole different viewpoint about it. I love this message because it gives you a burden. God is so beautiful to tell us about this place. Not only that, Jesus believed in it so much that he went to the cross to redeem us from it. Hell is real. This is one of those messages you need to understand. And hell is a reality. Revelation 21:8, it gives a list of who will go to hell. And I guarantee you, every one of us here, we fit that list. Paul said, but such were some of you. Such were some of every one of us. We can fall in that category, but thank God for Jesus Christ. Now, I fear hell, but I don't fear hell in the sense of going there. I respect the judgments of God, and we need to respect them. You know, I taught at one of the Bible colleges, had a bunch of pastors took my class. I did a series on the reality of hell. At the close of the conference, close of the session, one of the pastors, he came to me and said, Brother Perkins, you know something? I will never, ever joke about hell again. He said, I'll never joke about it again. At the Bible college, I had a lady. The president of the college came to me and said, Brother Perkins, I have five ladies want to take your class. I think they're lesbian. Do you mind? I said, no, let them come. This lady took my class. Now, in this class, I went through the whole series, and just so happened, the reality of hell was in one of the series that semester. Now, I did not call them out. I didn't rebuke them, call them sodomites. I did none of that. I just preached the gospel. At the close of that session on the reality of hell, these five women said, Brother Perkins, we need to talk to you tonight. You share something that we have never heard before. We are part of a church that tell us that we can be lesbian and go to heaven. What you share tonight, we have never heard before. And those women denounced the lifestyle, came out of lesbianism, and became radically saved. I mean, radically saved. Preaching the gospel. Just preach the truth. Listen, saying, just preach the truth and love on them. Preach the gospel and love on them. These women, I mean, one lady said, Brother Perkins, you got to help me, man. She said, I'm going after, help me tone it down a little bit. She was radical, boy. She was going after the people in her life to get them saved. One lady, you know, she was transitioning to look like a guy, and I watched this lady become a woman in the class. She surrendered her life to God, the word of God. Hell is a real message. We need to understand that. We don't need to sugarcoat it. We need to just preach the truth of the gospel. And when we do that, people are excited. Now I got, look at my time. I got a few more seconds, a few more minutes, really. I'm almost done. Now, I'm looking at your faces, and I know you say, Brother Perkins, please get off that hell slide. Just get off of that slide, please. I'm tired. Like, I got the message. I got it. Well, I'm going to take you to eternity. Look at this. The new heavens and new earth. I love this. This is our eternity, saints. I'm going to say this before I go to the next slide. You know, see, we've been taught some wacky stuff. See, I was taught that when you go to heaven, you know, we're going to get white wings and we're going to fly all over heaven, float on clouds, eating Philadelphia cream cheese. Unbiblical. We've been taught that when you die, you become an angel. Unbiblical, saints. Listen, if you become an angel when you die, you are unredeemable. Jesus never died for angels, ever. No, you don't become angels. Your baby don't become cherubs. No, he died for humanity. And listen, our future, I'm going to say this to you, and this is a strong one. I'm going to say this. I know you've been taught well here. We will not spend eternity in the third heaven. No, we will go to heaven, but we're going to spend eternity on the new earth, the brand new earth that Peter said that God's going to renovate, the very earth that Jesus paid for at Calvary, the creation. God's going to renovate planet earth. The Bible said the fire of God will try this earth. And Peter said, when it's done, we will have a new earth and new heavens. And I said, we're going to see the new earth the way Adam and Eve saw it when God created in the beginning. Revelation 22:3 says there'll be no more curse. And what's going to happen? The new Jerusalem will come out of the third heaven, and it will now come down upon the new earth. And saints, we're going to spend eternity with God on planet earth, but it's going to be a new earth without sin, without a devil, without funeral homes, graveyard. It's going to be awesome. This is an artist's rendition of the New Jerusalem. It's a massive city. I hope you can see that. These little specks here, these are white specks. These are saints glorified. They're walking into the city. It's going to be awesome, man. Jesus said, in my Father's house are many mansions, are many dwelling places. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. Guess what? We're going to have our dwelling places in that house, man. You know, Pastor Andy, I've been inviting Christians from all over the world to come to my house in the New Jerusalem. Yeah. So I'm going to give you the invitation. You come to my brother Perkins' house in the new world. I've asked God, I say, Father, I want two big old pretty lions out front of my door, Leo and Cleo. Two big, nice lions. And guess what? Come by my house, my lions won't bother you. It's going to be awesome, saints. Listen, our future will be a tangible, touchable eternity. See, we made our future so spooky and so mystical that we don't see the practicality of eternity. We'll have houses and homes in the new world. We'll have family. We'll be able to fellowship. We'll be able to eat. The Bible said the tree of life is going to be in the new world. You know, the tree of life, the Bible says in the New Jerusalem, it's going to bear 12 manner of fruits and yield a different fruit every month. And the Bible said we'll have a right to eat of the tree of life every month. Brother Perkins is at the tree. Saints, I believe the word of God. Our future is going to be so beautiful. And again, I mean, God is so beautiful and so eloquently placed what he has in store for us in the word of God. And again, we must spend time in his word to understand where we are. You know, this has given me so much hope. I know now why the devil tried to tell me if I studied this book, I would lose my mind. Because he didn't want me to see the future. You know, the Bible is the only book that we do that to. And what I mean by that is this. How many you get a book, a good book you're going to read. You read the beginning of the book, the middle of the book, and then you throw the book away. How many do that? The Bible is the only one we do that to. No, you get the book, you read the beginning, the middle, and by the time you get to the middle, man, you're so excited. I want to find out what happened. You want to know the end of the story. Well, the Bible gives us the end of the story. God closed the last book in the Bible with a prophetic book that gives us the end of our story. And we need to understand it. We need to long for it. I cannot wait for the future. You know, I love about it too. We're going to spend time in the new world. We'll see the patriarchs of old. You know, I want to see Daniel. I want to talk to Daniel. Daniel, how was it in the lion's den? I want to talk to the three Hebrew boys. Man, how was it, fellas, when you were cast into the fiery furnace? Tell me about it. Give me your testimony. Yeah, we're going to fellowship with the patriarchs of old in the new world. It's going to be awesome. And this is only for the redeemed. And again, saints, I love what the Bible gives us in regards to our future. Now, I've given you a lot. I know I have, and we went pretty fast here. But God has a divine order, and it's already in the scriptures. If we spend time, we'll see it. God want to use you to encourage this world who has no hope. God want to use you to challenge your loved ones, your friends, your co-workers, people that you know, people that God bring across your path. God wants you to challenge them to come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And if you do that, we'll have more people in heaven with us. That's for sure. I want you to bow your hearts as I close this morning. Father God, I love you. And again, I thank you so much for the word of truth. Lord, there's so much hope in the word of God. Lord, you are God that give it to us in advance. And Lord, you reveal it before it happens. And God, as you've already prophesied things and things have come to pass, Lord, I know the things that are still yet to come will come to pass. Lord, help us to make this world jealous of our future. Lord, forgive us, oh God, for the times, oh God, we've been lackadaisical in our walk with you, and we have not spent time with you, or we have given up, or we've backslidden on you. God, forgive us. Lord, bring us closer to you, dear God. Give us a hunger in these latter days for the word of God like we've never had before. Lord, give us your burden for the harvest. Lord, give us your heart. Let us see humanity the way you see humanity. Give us your heart, Lord, in these latter days. And Lord, use every one of us to serve you. Now, Lord, we love you. And if there's anyone here today that don't know you, Lord, before they leave, dear God, Lord, let them come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Now, Lord, I love you and I thank you this day. In Jesus' name. Amen. Isn't God good, saints? Amen. Yes, he is. Pastor.